management of the in-hospital hyperglycemia is both art and science. And especially when you have a large hospital setting where various different type of patients are admitted. So goals differ, patients' movement differs, and it's a huge chance for anyone to take care of good glycemic control and also get a good OPD follow-up. So as you all know, that diabetes control is pathetic in outpatient setting, and so when a person is admitted in, So when a person is admitted in a hospital, we expect that the glycemic control is not going to go good. So that gives another challenge for the management of the diabetes. So my all colleagues will help you in understanding the glycemic control in a hospital setting. So hyperglycemia is a common comorbidity in medical and surgical in a community hospital, but when it comes to our hospital, in our CABG and PTCA ward, approximately 40 to 50% of the people are having hyperglycemia. That includes both diabetes and new onset hyperglycemia. So if you see in this particular slide, so so normoglycemia in 62%, this survey by Yumperit and Ott et al. And if you look at 26% were non-diabetic and 12% were new onset hyperglycemia. This situation varies from the type of the hospital you are working in. In our hospital, as I told you, around 40 to 50% of the people are coming with the hyperglycemia and diabetes. So regarding the what is the evidence for the inpatient control of diabetes, so look at this slide, how the mortality changes. So hyperglycemia and mortality in medical intensive care unit, as the glucose level start increasing above 100 up to 199, there is a two-fold increase in the mortality, further increase up to 300 by threefold, and more than 300 it increases by fourfold. So increasing hyperglycemia, increasing mortality. Similarly, if you look at here, so a newly diagnosed diabetes as well will have a high chance of having the mortality in inpatient care because you are not aware about the hyperglycemia of that particular patient, and compare with the patient with the normal glucose level, patient with diabetes will have excess mortality. So what are the mechanism for adverse effect of hyperglycemia in acute illness? So this just pathophysiology based science, what is the reason for that? So illness lead to stress hyperglycemia. So stress will increase the stress response of the cortisol, epinephrine, and the, of course these hormone will further impair the glucose utilization at the level of the liver and also at the level of the muscle. So there will be excess glucose, and the lipolysis will increase and increase in the free fatty acid production. These level fatty acid, high fatty acid and high glucose level and illness will increase the risk of the hemodynamic insult, increase electrolytes losses, oxidative stress, myocardial injury, hypercoagulability, and altered immunity, all resulting into the decrease in wound in healing, increased inflammation, and endothelial dysfunction. And this becomes a vicious cycle of illness and increased glucose in inpatient care setting. And you get a very limited chance to intervene here and to break this vicious cycle of the stress hyperglycemia and high glucose level resulting into the this kind of the damage. So outcome, now looking at what is the outcome, so of inpatient hyperglycemia resulting into the better outcome, like clinical outcome. So studies after 2000 have shown that like if you are targeting for good glycemic control, early intervention trial, so decrease infection, mortality at 1 year, and even the survival up to 2 years. So these are the studies which showed that it gives an encouraging result in different kind of the patient population, like CABG, the mixed patient, and the and non-cardiac patient, that the mortality does decrease with early intervention. Now, this slide shows you the better outcome results. So intensive insulin therapy in critically ill patient in ICU have shown either non-significant result, But if you see in the RABBIT2 trial by Umpirej in surgical ICU, it has shown a significant difference in terms of the outcome. But only thing is that in the NICE sugar study showed an increase in mortality if you are aiming for too tight glycemic control. So I would like to just briefly tell about here the NICE sugar study. In NICE sugar study, the intensive arm actually aimed at a glucose level of around below 100, and they were able to achieve around 118, and the conventional arm were able to achieve 145. Therefore, there is 90-day mortality. The p-value is becoming significant here, so 90-day mortality was higher in a patient with the tight glycemic control. So this approach suggests that probably a midway approach is better. So I will just share you about the target. So what should is the takeaway from these trials? That good glycemic control is required. There is excess mortality. As opposed to the near normal control, it should not be approached for. Hyperglycemia and hypoglycemia are both marker of the poor outcome. So both ends are bad in critically and non-critically ill patients. My colleague will discuss about that. And recent study shows that the fair control, apart from the laser fair attitude towards the inpatient, should be avoided. So current recommendations suggest that, I think probably this is better to remember, the recommended target in the most of the patient is between 140 to 180. Above 180, you have to intervene, should not be aimed for. And acceptable is between 110 to 140 in some subsets of the patient. Below 110 is again not recommended. And similar is from the different ACE and ADA recommendation in non-ICU setting. Pre-meal target is below 140 and random glucose and bedtime glucose below 180 is, and avoid hypoglycemia. You need to reassess if the glucose level is falling below 100. Hypoglycemia is defined in a hospital care setting below 70, and severe hypoglycemia, because you will not, patient will not come ask for third party assistance, below 40 is the severe hypoglycemia. So these recommendations are again validated in the recent publication, either in diabetes care. This is the latest edition, diabetes care in the hospital, standard of medical care in diabetes care 2022, and also from the endocrine society, the management of the hyperglycemia in hospitalized adult patient with a non-critical care setting. Now, I will take you something different. The strategies for the effective discharge, you have managed well. My colleague will talk about the management. So how we should discharge the patient, because in 4 or 5 days or even 7 days, you have to plan everything. And you have to discharge patient, and you have to, patient should follow you in OPD care as well. So there is a relationship between the inpatient and outpatient diabetes management. Outpatient depends upon the compliance, and glycemic goal depends upon the patient. In hospital, management is entirely our responsibility. So compliance and glycemic goal depends upon physician, nursing, and hospital staff. So if we have a better system here, so we will probably give a good glycemic control and avoid to reach those targets. So discharge planning should start from the beginning. So why there is a problem? So pressure of the discharge patient early, when the patient's procedure is done or patient becomes all right for the current problem for which patient is admitted. So there is a pressure for discharge. Billing in especially in the private hospital has to be minimized. Shorter hospital stay, competing priorities are there. Lack of the primary care physician, nursing workload, lack of the diabetes specialist educator, and the weekend discharge. So all these factors results into the discharge without any diabetes advice, and that often happens. Many a time we get a call, our patient been discharged, we were diabetic, we were given insulin in the hospital, and we don't have any discharge advice. So this needs to be coordinated as soon as the patient is admitted. So create a collaborative team, identify patients with hyperglycemia and diabetes, develop an individualized team plan for each patient, and determine the transition of the discharge strategy and monitor the progress. So we have a team, whenever a patient gets admitted, the patient is seen by our team. We have consultant and our DNB fellows in endocrinology who are following. They follow the patient 24/7. And our diabetes educators start meeting patient from the beginning, and they go with the discharge with the diabetes education regarding the diet, insulin, and our coordinator then follow the patient in OPD basis. So this is how a teamwork helps, and it becomes very simple for us, but it took around first 3-4 years to reach to this level of the smooth the IPD care. So transition from the from hospital to outpatient care, preparation for transition to outpatient setting should begin at the time of the hospital admission, and it is a multidisciplinary team. So one person cannot help you, bedside nurse, a team of doctor, which of course consultant is there, and then junior doctor, resident doctor, DNB fellows, registered dietitian and educator is there, and finally your coordinator who is following patient in OPD. So there should be clear communication regarding that. Outpatient provide care in the critical care, ensuring the successful transition to outpatient management. And this is how, because as I told you, 70 to 80% will have poor glycemic control, and this gives you a good opportunity to give good glycemic control for patient benefit as well as for your OPD, bringing your OPD numbers and maintaining a good OPD follow-up, and patient will definitely follow you in long term. So pre-discharge checklist should be there, diet information, monitoring and strip. Patient should be able to take care of the glucometer, how to monitor the glucose, prescription for supplies of the medication, including needles. So in our hospital, we give demo in each floor and how to take insulin, and at least once or twice, patient or caregiver do help them in getting the insulin dose done over their self. Treatment goals are defined. My colleague will help you in understanding that. Contact number for OPD follow-up should be given, and sick days in hypoglycemia training and skill is taught to the patient. So discharge planning depend upon the etiology of the hyperglycemia. You may have a patient with the stress hyperglycemia that resolved in the hospital, and you have to just tell patient to get some glucose level, a glucose level and HbA1c after time, some time. Previously undiagnosed diabetes, plan to confirm the diagnosis and implement therapy and education as per the need. And previously diagnosed patient is the largest chunk, and as I told you, most of these patients are poorly controlled, and there this gives you a good window of opportunity to intervene and help them in getting good glycemic control, understand the diabetes so that minimize the complication in other organ cells as well. And outpatient follow-up can be done. So HbA1c does help you in giving a good idea about the post-discharge treatment. So always HbA1c should be done whenever your patient is admitted in hospital. Glucose and HbA1c are two important things. Glucose is like a vital for any individual whosoever comes to the hospital. And once the glucose level is high, so you should definitely get HbA1c, and we will discuss that in further discussion. So HbA1c more than 6.5%, that is inpatient diabetes, refer to diabetes education and self-management to be talked. If it is below between 5.5 or 5.7 to 6.4, so these are the people with the stress hyperglycemia, their diet, exercise and weight, everything should be discussed. Probably they may not require anti-diabetic therapy, if at all, will be for a brief period. Now here comes the, depending upon the glucose level between 6.5 to 7.5, you may have to change the plan. You may add a third agent, non-insulin agent. You may discuss about the basal insulin. Further comes between 7.6 to 9%. Already in two non-insulin agents, at least add a basal insulin at bedtime here. More than 9%. Discharge should be done on the basal bolus, and especially if the patient is already undergone a major surgery, should be discharged on the basal bolus. Never immediately put patient on the oral agent and basal insulin, because many times the glucose control worsen. Over the time, if you have opportunity to add any oral antidiabetic drug like SGLT2 inhibitor, GLP analog or the DPP4 inhibitor, that will definitely help patient in decreasing the glucose level. Then you can discuss about the convenient insulin approach, twice daily premix co-formulation and less complex insulin regime. But these are the people who would require insulin definitely in long term. So in summary, patient need for diabetes education has to be assessed preferably upon the admission, and glucose control, glycemic targets, and their compliance should be addressed at that point of the time. And most importantly, they should be educated about the importance of the good glycemic control in long run. So many times they understand it easily, especially if they have a directly diabetes related complication like retinopathy, nephropathy or cardiovascular disease. But other time, if they are admitted with a different purpose, probably they may not give a good weightage towards the glycemic control. So it's our responsibility, because they are with us for next five, 7 days. During that 5-7 days, whatever the best we have to give them a teaching. Patient has received the necessary skill and training. So education is the most important here. Provider post-discharge plan for diabetes and follow-up plan should be given them. Patient has received clear instruction about the medication, name, doses, when to take, and many times you will get a call that I have taken the bolus insulin instead of the basal insulin and the dose reverses other way around. Patient have a scheduled follow-up appointment at the time of the discharge. So in our from our discharge advice, we write after 3 days, at least they will communicate with us through telemedicine. And later on, when they are coming for scheduled hospital visit, they will see us in person. So written documentation of the point of care would be completed at the time of the discharge. So.